you got fans.
I don't know, because I don't know them like that.
Rory's the Irish redhead, and Maul is obviously black, so like that would be you.
So I have to be Maul because I'm black.
I'm not black.
And
I'm also not Irish. Definitely not.
Yeah, it's a family.
My last name is Blevins. That's probably Irish.
I gotta look it up.
Yes. Overdid today.
Oh, hey. Imagine you guys leave me and I do a pod with Zoma and Rose.
Don't do it. No. Welsh. So I'm Welsh.
You're Welsh?
Oh, you're Welsh?
Yeah. Welsh. I'm not Welsh. Black. I'm OJ.
Hey, before you get
hold on. When you said Welsh, I thought of grape. Like grape juice.
That's Welsh is, not Welsh.
Oh, well, same thing.
Oh my gosh, man.
Which was a drink growing up for sure. Sugar filled drink.
Yeah. Grape drink. I don't like grape drink.
No?
Look. My card is probably about to be pulled. I'm a white grape juice kind of guy.
Okay. Hey, nothing wrong with that.
I don't do the purple. Like I can't. I don't like it at all. But some strawberry soda, I'll take some of that down though.
Okay. Are you a Shasta guy or are you
Shasta? Hell no. No.
Fanta?
That's for poor people.
Well, damn.
Fanta? Yeah. We could do a strawberry one, yeah, for sure. Not on a regular, but yeah.
That Shasta's carbonation is on a whole nother level. That stuff is coming out your nose.
You ever had Tiki Punch?
That's nasty too, man. That's what back when I was growing up, y'all probably drank it, but all the people that I hung out with would drink Tampico.
That's horrible, bro.
The worst. The like worst.
When you drink it, you get diabetes.
You guys are clowning me. You guys are clowning, but we used to have to drink Kool-Aid all the time, right? So we used to have to make it.
And when you had to drink Kool-Aid?
That was our only drink. Like, it was either water or Kool-Aid. So when we used to go to the 99 cent store, Tampico used to be there. Oh my God. When we had Tampico, that was like champagne to us.
This trash. That was champagne to you, and that's trash.
We were only drinking Kool-Aid for like 12 years straight.
I'd rather have Kool-Aid than Tampico, man.
If you had Kool-Aid for 12 years straight and you got Tampico for the first time,
it's nasty.
We didn't even drink orange juice. It was like breakfast. You had pancakes, Kool-Aid.
But the thing that it's like a psychological thing. So like the Kool-Aid, it's the powder. You mix it with the water. You got to put in the work. So then with the Tampico, it's already done. You just pour it.
Wait, you talking about crack or are you talking about Kool-Aid?
That's no
the powder, mix it with the water. We're not talking about Snowfall yet.
That's what I learned on Snowfall.
We're gonna get there. What else is going on in the world, Andy?
Shoot, man. Just been working a lot.
We working, fam,
for real. So I'm on like a 10-day stretch right now. Reason being because Jesse and I are going to provide a little bit of content for probably our next pod. So, like, Jesse and I are going to be heading to Dubai. So, yeah,
We should do a podcast out there while you guys are out there.
I mean, we got our phone. We could do it on the phones. Like, we could do that.
Live destination.
We working, fam, special, YouTube special. Because he's going to bring his GoPro. I'm going to bring my GoPro. We're just going to be throwing it around. We'll FaceTime
you. FaceTime me. Right. But I'm good though, just working. What about you guys? What about you, Bless, since you asked me?
Man, today was hectic, worked all day, finally got a haircut. I'm out here looking sharp for the first time in I don't know how long.
You got the lineup?
Yeah, you know, kept the beard. We're gonna keep the beard growing. We'll see how, you know, how long it gets. I'm gonna battle Jesse, you know, for beard supremacy.
Over there
with the, as he got the Zorro mustache and the peach fuzz. Okay. Chin strap.
Little hair under the lip.
Yeah, look like, hey, he and Julian are going through puberty at the same time.
Oh, man. You guys share the.
Julian's growing his hair down low and Jesse's growing his up top. On his face.
Y'all clown the Zorro mustache, man. I'd be trying to maintain it, you know? Can't get over the lip.
You got the Stephen A. mustache.
It's funny because when I look at mustaches, I see people how like it lines up right at the lip. Mm-hmm. Mine starts looking all fuzzy, and I try to trim mine right above the lip. But I see how people have their mustache different, where they just line up the top and just have it right under the lip. I can't do that. I wish I can. So I'm beggars can't be choosers. Whatever I could get, I'm just gonna.
Have you ever considered getting a fake mustache? I'm being serious.
I didn't even know that's such a thing.
Yeah, of course. You don't remember the Fresh Prince episode where he pretended like he was Ashley's father, and she was like, "That's a fake mustache."
That'd be crazy. Somebody walking into a spot saying, "Let me get the Steve Harvey."
the Humpty goggles.
Oh my gosh.
So. But me, man, same here, man. I just been working. I'm looking forward to this vacation. Super excited to get away for a change.
Get away from your wife and kids. Since you've been transitioning, is that why you're trying to get away?
Man, I don't even want to go there, man. I'm hurting. I'm tired because
my heart hurts. Things have escalated.
Things have escalated, but I can't share yet, man. Soon. Okay.
All right.
Soon. All right.
No doubt. Wait, he didn't get nobody pregnant, did he?
No.
And Aubrey is.
Aubrey's perfect.
Okay. Yeah. All right. I'll just make a
I think Jesse would be in jail if all that happened.
Yeah, we'll talk about off mic, but yeah. It escalated. It went from a 2 to a 13.
Oh, hell.
Dang. How are you doing mentally? Because it was taxing you before.
That's why when I was talking to Blevs, I was like, let's try to be positive. He laughed.
Yeah, you're pre-production. You're like, I'm here for the funnies.
I'm trying to enlighten my life. And
I don't want to talk about the sad. I'm already sad.
Dang, we do got to get to we'll get to the good. But mm-hmm. Yeah, we got some unfortunate too, right, Andy?
Yeah, so unfortunate things that obviously we have to talk about in this world that we live with every single day. And so there's a young gentleman by, his name is Dante Wright, out of Minnesota, I believe, right? It was in Minnesota.
Lincoln Center, Minnesota.
Yeah, so it was a body cam that was released recently where he was pulled over and he resisted arrest. He clearly did resist, but what transpired was that the officer, and I forget the officer's name right now. Do we know her name?
No.
No, but it doesn't matter. We don't need to say her name. But so as he was resisting, the officer claimed to pull out a taser, but clearly for a good maybe 10, 15 seconds while he was resisting, she had her gun out the whole time. You can see it in the body cam, and shot Dante one time, and unfortunately he ended up passing away. And the police department and everything, they're basically trying to cover it up and at the same time basically defend the fact that they felt that she was just making an honest mistake.
Justify
the fact that, she's claiming that the whole time she thought she had her taser out. And
From what I understand,
mm-hmm.
Officers, they put their gun on their dominant side, mm-hmm. and they put the taser on the opposite side. And so if you're right-handed, then your gun is going to be on the right side. If you're left-handed, it's going to be, on the left side. And so, and there's clearly a weight difference between a gun and a taser. The feeling of a gun and a taser is completely different as well. So it's crazy. You talked about cover up, the word is that she's helped other people cover up incidents to where they should have been reprimanded. So
look, like inside, like this is my feeling towards everything. Like, and I, man, from I got like a little bit emotional when I even started watching the video, when I saw at the bottom like the headline, it said that she had been an officer for 25 years
26.
And
26,
and I thought to myself, like, this is the one body cam image footage that got out. How many more are there? And like, that's when I thought about it was a life, like, and how many other lives have been impacted by this. I'm not gonna lie, like, that all this stuff always affects me, because I always think about, like, white, black, it don't matter what it is, like, it's a person, it's a person's life, and then their families get affected. family and friends, obviously. But the more that I thought about it, I was like, where's the footage with non-black people? Like, when does that happen to them? It's always a black person, always.
It happens, but they handle the situations much, much differently. And it sucks because this young man was 20 years old, a father, I believe, right?
Yeah.
And that's it. No more. And I believe he called his mother during the incident.
Like after,
and
right?
No, like, oh, I think it was during the altercation.
Like, hey, I got pulled over. And they pulled him over for what? Having air fresheners hanging up in the rearview mirror?
That's just an excuse. That reminds me of a time when I was, I think I might have been with Jesse. I don't know. I forget. But I was probably like 16, 17. No, I was like 18 or 19. And we ended up going to, this was back when we were making music. And we went to this individual's house. And he was making music. And we just went to go hang out, listen to some beats. So, but it wasn't the best part of town. And anyways, I got pulled over. And I was extremely scared when I got pulled over. It was one of those times where you just feel like it just don't feel right. And so at the moment, what I did is I actually dialed my dad's number as I was getting pulled over. And I told him, hey, Dad, I just got pulled over. I'm just going to have you on the phone just in case. I want you to listen to everything. But that feeling to have to do that and have fear, and I'm Hispanic, it's a different type of feeling. And that's the emotions that came out of me, because I thought to myself, like, damn, like, I probably escaped that possibly happening to myself. And that just the fear that when you get pulled over, and you shouldn't have to have that fear, you know what I mean? And so, like, I kind of relived that moment when I heard that, you know, he called his mom, you know, right before or during. And that I actually experienced something like that. Obviously, I didn't, you know, the outcome wasn't the same, but just having to do something like that and live in this world is tough.
Yeah, no, that's very unfortunate. Today I was writing, and I don't know if it was just a warning, if it was a sign. Drove past a cop car, it went behind me. I wasn't speeding at all, but it just came, you know, behind me. And I was like, oh, shoot. I'll tell you like how the story progressed. But the first thing that I thought of in my head, I was about 10 minutes away from my house. And I'm not trying to be insensitive at all, but I was just saying to myself, please don't get pulled over because I have to use the restroom. I hope I don't get pulled over because I'm going to be hot because I've been holding it. It was a long day at work. I just wanted to get home. I was looking at my speed limit. It was like 45. That's what the speed limit said. But there was construction going down. So I was like, okay, well, am I supposed to slow down? But I'm trying to just go with the flow. And then he flashed his, he has a head beam in the center. He flashed it one time. So I was like, oh, shit. But I'm like, look at my beard, like, just scared. And
you peed on yourself.
So I slowed down a little bit. Slow down. And then he flashed his high beams at me again, his high beams this time. So it was his outer lights. So I was like, oh shit, what is he telling? Am I going too fast? I don't know. Is he just telling me like, hey, slow down, or what is he doing? Mm-hmm. And so I went like 39. So I finally, we finally turned onto my street, and he kind of went, there was some cones in the street. So then I kind of stopped and I had to wait for him to go. And as soon as I stopped, he put his lights on. So I was like, oh shit. I was like, what did I do wrong? But luckily he just was helping the guy with the cones, the sirens out to help the guy. I don't know if he had a flat tire or what, but it was just a scary feeling. Like, yes, it still sucks, but like, it was a whole 10 minutes of him following me, flashing his lights. I was very uncertain. But that's just an uneasy feeling to have.
But think about your experience. Like, your experience is like, you were more worried about like, I'm trying to go to the restroom, right? And the fear wasn't really there for you. And that's in 2021. And you talking about Andy having that fear in what, 2004 or 5, it was. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, for you to have that fear back then And, you know, we know that this has been going on forever, but it wasn't really, it hasn't been prevalent in the media.
Because social media.
And in society like it has been the last several years. And you did have that fear versus you now. And we see it all the time, you know, and you don't have that fear. And I think, you know, that really speaks to, you know, just all of our different experiences, you know, in every walk of life that we live and come across and encounter with, you know, everyday people. And it's important to put yourself in somebody else's shoes and to have empathy and to hear what somebody else's story is, because you don't know what they've gone through or what they've experienced. You know what I mean? So empathy and love and listening, you know, are vital in our society. Not that that's the answer for healing and everything in our world, but you know, it's one of the things that can help us in our communities. So, but what's crazy to me is that you have the George Floyd trial that's going on right now. And while that's going on, you have this, the same thing, essentially, not, you know, it's not apples to apples, but you know, another police murder of a black man going on while we're having a trial about it. Like, that's a crazy situation to me. Like, not that it's happening in general in America right now, but it's happening in the same place. You know what I mean? The same state that this huge national trial is going on in.
Yeah.
Pretty wild to me.
And I bet a lot of them are on edge too. So even more on edge.
You know it.
Well, that's the thing. So I was in a conversation recently where, like, I was just listening in, where somebody else was saying, well, like, they shouldn't resist. But I'm like, yo, but how do you not, when we're traumatized by what we see and what the experiences that other people are having, like, how do we not know that that's going to not happen to us? You know what I mean? And a lot of people grow up knowing, especially in the black community, I feel like, I'm sure conversations are had between family members where, like, this is what you do when you get pulled over, right? Like, that's a conversation. I know that's a black family conversation that I'm sure happens, right? But it also happens in the Hispanic community as well. Whether for us, it might be like, hey, you might be an undocumented individual. How do you deal with that when you get pulled over, right?
Wow.
There's a certain way to deal with that. And that's a conversation, especially for some of us to have family members that are over here just trying to better their lives. It's like, yo, you don't be out by a certain time. And if you are, and if you get pulled over, this is what you say. This is who you know. This is where you live. But if it, and then if it doesn't, guess what? You're getting taken wherever, like, or you getting beaten or whatever. Things happen to us too. They just are not as, they're not out in the media as much, which that's kind of like, I'm not sure why that is, honestly. And I feel like there's a motive behind that, especially in this country. But what bothers me is that when people say stuff like that, like Jet Blevins says, they're empathetic towards the reality of what is happening right now every single day. And that's the problem, where we're not open and showing love to one another and hearing the stories that obviously are happening. And so that bothers me, honestly. And I think the best thing to do is, like what Blevins said, is, you know, show love, try to understand, and show some kindness, because you never know what people are going through or what they've been through or how they feel about that situation.
So the person you were having a conversation with, what was their background?
They're white.
Okay.
Yeah.
There you go. And the crazy thing is, you're like, well, just comply. Like, okay, well, I mean, there's so many instances where somebody did comply and they still are no longer with us, or they complied and then it got to a certain point to where, like, how much disrespect are you going to take from somebody? You know what I mean? How much abuse are you going to take from somebody before you kind of And it's already a pressure cooker situation as it is, right? Mm-hmm. And you have so many instances of, you know, and we've said it on the show before, to where people are committing mass murder and they getting put in handcuffs and get to, you know, go to the station or get to go to Burger King on the way to the station. And even in, it was crazy, man. And Huntington, I think it was this past weekend, they had a White Lives Matter rally. And so there were counter protesters there. And I saw scenes of the police protecting someone that was agitating the counter protesters. And they arrested at least, two people. One was a black man because of a noise ordinance, because he was playing his music too loud in the area. Yeah, you know what I mean? So it's like comply, comply, comply. Well, the rules got to be the same for everybody, and they're not.
Yeah,
they're
that's,
not.
That's the problem. Oh well, that's one of the problems. But yeah, what I would like to see though, I'm gonna just call him out because obviously I voted for him. So let me just be transparent. Like I would love to hear from Biden. Like right now would be the time.
I know, and I've been so busy, man. I haven't really been keeping up on like what's going on, you know, politically and socially as much. But I know like there's some things in the works of what he's trying to do in terms of like background checks with guns and, you know, all kind of stuff. So I mean,
let's just hope
there's a lot of work to be done. Yeah, there's so much stuff going on. It's like, where do you start? So at the end of the day, like a politician is a politician. So I'm not finna cape for him. I'm glad he's there versus what the alternative was. You know, and I do like some of the things that are going on, but again, at the end of the day, it's politics. So you're not gonna like it all, and appreciate it all, and all of it ain't gonna be right. But I think so far so good, and we'll see. You know, in terms of, you know, the other things that you're mentioning, the other things that we really need in our society. So you know, but we had that one loss, and we had a huge loss on an international level that occurred, you know, last week, and has really been going on for, you know, almost 2 weeks now.
Yeah.
You know, that was DMX.
DMX, man. Rest in peace.
Yeah, we got to bring DMX in. So I'm about to play one of my favorite songs ever, and you guys probably never heard of it, or you haven't heard it in a long time. So let's go.
The dog. Here comes the dog.
You remember this thing?
This is on a Def Jam compilation album, right? Jamaican one. Here comes
the boom. Here comes the boom. Dang, I said it wrong, man. Yeah, dude, do the dog. Do the boom. You get it. Off into town. Turn them like a mountain. Let them have a spit in a blood like a fountain. Look at me like that. You just might fight black. And that fight might end up in me taking your life. I don't go for the bullshit. Get up and down. The time is just too important to be fucking around.
Then he gets crazy right there. He goes.
Man, I said it wrong. Here comes the bone. That was a bop right there, man. That was a tough song.
Yeah. That was on the Def Jam like Jamaican compilation, right? See.
And it was on the Belly soundtrack too.
That's what it was.
Okay.
It was on the Belly. I think it did so well. They did do a Def Jam compilation album that I had. I was the only one that had that album.
You actually put me. I think you put me on to that. But
man, it was dope.
Yeah, it was on Belly.
Okay. Top Shotter.
Yeah. Shot that. That's a track right there.
Yeah, that's a crazy song to have. But no, man, we lost a legend. I know Andy and I kind of talk about it that we were. You know, we were able to see him twice.
Oh, really?
See him perform?
What? Nah, never.
No, okay.
Ever.
You got to tell. So, Jesse, from was it my 28th or something birthday? 30. Oh, my 30th birthday. He actually surprised me, and he got us tickets to the Roots Picnic in Philly.
Oh, I remember when y'all went, yeah.
Yeah. So we, you know, we got to see him live. Like, this dude rocked I don't know how many. It was like 50,000 fans, maybe 100,000. I don't know. But it was a lot of people there. And
my side of the story.
That's fine. No, that's fine. But, like, he had everybody's attention. Out of everybody that was there, every performer that was there, like, I felt like everybody was there to see him. And like he controlled the crowd. He had the crowd moving and jumping. Like it was special, for sure. So I'm glad that we got to see him live. I don't know, you could tell your side of the story, Jesse.
So that, I think that was the big point that we wanted to go, was to see DMX, right? Mm-hmm. I think Usher and the Roots headline, which was cool. We looked at it, but we were really going there for DMX. We saw Kate Trinata, Little Uzi. Who else did we see there? Anderson Paak. Anderson Paak was nice.
Will Smith.
Will Smith, yeah. So it was just a dope show to go to. But what really stood out and why I really wanted to go was the whole DMX experience, right? Oh, and Swiss Beatz was there too. Perform. He did his own set. Oh, yeah. So Andy knows like I'm a big Swiss Beatz guy. So I was like, hey,
Swiss or Swiss?
Swiss. I said Swiss, okay. Like cheese.
Yeah.
Swiss.
Swissy. Swiss.
So we went to the stage that he was at, and we were thinking, like, our thought process was like, well, they're probably gonna have DMX here, right? But no, DMX was on the main stage, far left, right? So there was about four different stages. So we was rocking, and I remember I was telling Andy, hey, we're gonna, you know, after this, DMX is gonna perform, so we're gonna have to head over there. Man, as soon as we turned like this, everybody was already looking at the stage over there for DMX. It was crazy. So we had to like maneuver in the crowd for a good 15 minutes. And we finally got close enough, which we were still in the middle of a pack. Mm-hmm. But we saw him ripping, man. I felt like it was that time when he did that Woodstock in front of the whole world. That energy, like, you know, that presence that he's able to do by himself. And then when Swizz came back out there and was his hype man, it was just unreal. He started jumping on the speaker. No, this is DMX. Started jumping on the speaker. It was one of the best experiences, one of the best shows that I've seen. And I was grateful that we were able to go out there and actually see him. And then the second time, we went to the Bad Boy anniversary, which was a dope show in LA. And Puff Daddy, P. Diddy, Sean Combs.
Diddy.
He bought him out, and he actually did his own little set there too. So we were able to get to see him back to back within a year span. It was amazing, man. I would never forget those performances. I'm a big DMX fan ever since I was a kid. My uncle, he was in the military. He would come home bumping the anthem, man. You could just hear him down the street. And he was from New York. So, you know, he had the tip, like he had the FUBU jersey. I couldn't afford the FUBU jersey, but he had it all. I was like, dang, man. So I really was I was really on DMX when he first came out because of my uncle. So in 98, I was on it already. I was a big fan. And yeah, that's my experience with him. But, you know, rest in peace. Great performer, great guy, very heartfelt. And man, that's a legend that it hit hard, man. That one hit hard to me.
Yeah, for me, unfortunately, I never got to see DMX. There have been some legends that I've been able to see before they pass, but I didn't get to see DMX. But like you said, the impact, man, like DMX came out when I was 13. So that was one of the years that I went to Jordan camp. And so all anybody was playing at the dorms that summer was DMX. It's Dark and Hell Is Hot. Nobody was playing nothing else. And that's when you had the big boom boxes, mm-hmm. and, you know, the speakers that you would bring to you, or your, you know, little mini stereo system that you would bring with you and your CD player and all that. That's all anybody was playing, man, was DMX. And I just fell in love with him because just his energy was just so raw and powerful. And when in the history of music have you heard anybody growl on a song, and every song, and multiple times within a song, right? Yeah. Never. That was something new, that was so fresh. And for me, I'll tell you my favorite DMX song, and you guys could let me know yours. But for me, a lot of times with a lot of hip-hop artists, for the most part, like, my favorite songs are on their first albums. And we all know what, you know, the first album is like compared to a lot of the other ones. But for me, my favorite DMX song is How's It Going Down. Like, I played that song over and over back then. Even before his passing, I would play the song all the time. always play the video when, you know, it would come on MTV Jams when videos were important. Like, that's my favorite DMX song.
Yeah. This whole, his passing hit hard, though. Just because I feel like he's one of the artists that we all grew up on. And in his age bracket, from people that actually got to have an impact by him as a person and his music, it ranges like to so many age brackets, because a lot of people related to his music. It really didn't have an age group. And so you have older hip hop heads that obviously that love him. You have like people like us and all of us that like in our age bracket, and even the younger cats, you know, now in their mid 20s, early 20s or late 20s that can appreciate his music, because I felt like he spoke to everybody. Like he really,
he was authentic. It was the authenticity.
Yeah. And then so I don't know if you guys ever watched the Rough Rider Chronicles. No. So that was a dope docuseries, right? And so from me watching that, I really got to appreciate DMX as a person and the struggles that it took him to simply make it as far as he did up until his 50s, and to come to a place where he got to. I would just say this, like a lot of people obviously were like grieving, right? For his death, and obviously we feel for his family and his family and friends. But when somebody's like suffering, like it felt like he's been suffering for a long time. Like you also,
since he was 14.
Yeah.
Well, longer than that, but
longer than that,
battling like with addiction since he was 14.
Like I'm talking about like he's been dealing with this since he was a kid, like from like his early stages with his mother and father. And you know, this is his life. And so when somebody finally gets to be at peace, and like he's put it in his music and his words, that he was a religious man and he had a relationship with God. So when he went, like, I just feel like, all right, he's home. You know what I mean?
And, well, I'm sure too. He, you talk about his music. I wonder, he probably didn't even expect to live as long as he did.
That's the thing. Like,
you know what I mean? And he still saw 50.
He made it to 50. And that's a long life compared to a lot of people, and the life that he led, you know, it's a blessing to have him that long.
Well, we know Jesse's favorite song is Top Shotta. Mine is how. What is it?
There's so many, man, but I think mine will probably be Party Up.
It would be.
Because how you make a diss song to Eminem and make it one of the hardest club songs ever? Like, how would you diss somebody? Like, that's one of the top diss songs because it's a club anthem. Like, how are you going to make a club anthem dissing somebody?
It would be. I'm not surprised. Andy, what's yours?
Mine's Slipping.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's a real song.
Yeah. That one's a song, man. Because like one of my favorite albums of his, because his realest is a Great Depression. Mm. I love that album, and he was going through it on that one. So
yeah, he has some dope, like Get At Me Dog.
Was that on that though, or was it on And There Was X?
No, that was on And There Was X, I believe. It was the Great Depression. It wasn't on that one.
That was when
that one. It was like that one had the one like da-da. I forget the name. Oh. Da-da, da-da. What was the name of that song?
Who We Be, I think.
Oh yeah, that song. Ooh. Yeah.
Oh
my goodness.
But he had, his features are dope, man. How you get Cisco and then Sheik Looch? Just hard.
Cisco on what song?
What These Girls Want.
Name them all.
Yolanda.
Yolanda, Talanda, Ronda, Honda, a Honda. Your mama.
Yeah, rest in peace, though, to a legend.
What's yours, though, Jesse?
Party Up.
Oh, you said Party Up. You just said that. You sure you want to stick with that?
It's tell me another diss song that's that crunk besides No Vaseline.
Did you just say crunk? Oh.
He took it.
This is all. This is can I be honest with you? I hate this song.
I think DMX in that Chronicles, he said he hated this song too.
Up in here. Y'all gonna make
me. Because I think if I remember right, this was at a point where it was just about the hit. Like, he just needed a hit. Like, he didn't want to do this song. I could be wrong, but that's what I remember.
I cannot stand that song.
So he's like, I'm just going to clown Eminem.
But it is a hit. It is a hit.
It's a hit, and it is definitely part of hip-hop culture.
Mm-hmm.
But what it's been turned into. I probably did like the song at the time,
mm-hmm.
but the fact that, like you said, a club anthem, I cannot stand that song. I can't stand it.
Why?
So sorry, because it's a club anthem.
Oh.
Like it's, you go to, not any of the clubs I was going to, but anytime you hear it, like you know who's on the dance floor and you know how they dancing and all that. I can't deal with that song. But I'm so appreciative. That's why I tweeted this the other day. Like, I'm appreciative of the fact that we got to see the dogs,
mm-hmm.
DMX and Snoop Dogg, perform on Versus. And that's one of the ones that we did the, like, we watched it live, right?
We documented it.
Yeah.
So that's tight. I mean, that's one of the things I love about.
I was rooting for the dog.
Which one?
DMX. Y'all was.
Oh, okay. Oh, I remember.
Yeah, now that's kind of the cool thing about that we did that is that we'll always have that back. We can always look back on that and be like, yeah. we could at least feel like we were part of it. You know what I mean? Yeah. And that's what he provided for us is like a moment. So I appreciate that too.
So that versus, and then what about Linen Suit versus? That was on Easter.
I made sure, Jess. So I was out there in San Antonio at Jesse's house, and I made sure. I was like, "Yo, we got."
Did you wear your linen suit?
No,
Jesse. Did you wear your linen suit?
Mm-hmm.
You didn't have your cognac, your cigar.
No, I didn't know they was dressing up like that.
Yeah.
So,
chinchilla.
We only watched a part of it because we was bit. But however.
Because it was right after the egg hunt, so
right
but we egg. Turned it right. We turned it on.
We turned it
right
on
after the egg hunt.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It came on at like 5:30. That's 7:30. What y'all was egg hunting in the dark?
It was light outside.
I heard like 9:30.
It was light outside.
But Andy and I actually were driving around the city all day Saturday, and we did listen to the cheat sheet all the way through, and we were scoring it. And we were, it was just like back and forth, huh? It was a tie.
Like, oh, like this is one. And it was hard for us to pick one.
Mm-hmm. So, but y'all didn't really listen to the Isleys or Earth, Wind, and Fire like that growing up, right?
I listened to Earth, Wind, and Fire because of my dad.
Okay.
Not the Isleys. My dad will always play Earth, Wind, and Fire.
And I've only known about the Isleys because of,
what's his name?
Oh, but that was
played. He played him too. He played the songs from him. So, like, what was your okay? So, you guys weren't really familiar with both of their catalogs like that. As you were listening to the Versus cheat sheet on Apple Music, like, how what was going through y'all's mind?
This is real to me. It was like, this is music. This is real music. Nothing like what it is nowadays, and it's just an appreciation to like how they birthed so many genres based on like the samples that were used from their music, and like to think that that's OG music, that's original music. Like, you got in the studio and like, all right, who's gonna play this instrument, that instrument, who's gonna say this, how are they gonna say that, who's gonna write this, and then piece it together, and now hundreds of thousands of songs have come from what they did originally. Like, that's what I thought. Like, damn, this is amazing. Like, you have more of a, I appreciate it more.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I totally agree, man. That listening to those songs, and it just brought me back. I'm like, man, I haven't heard these in a long time. Oh shoot, I didn't know they did this. And like you said, that musicianship is you could tell that it's there, and man, like I wish I could just be a fly in the room when they made that song or some of those songs, you know, just to see how that thought process was, you know, how they made it. But it was funny when I turned it on
when I turned it on, I turned it on in the middle. I think they had just, they were about to take a break, right? And I'm like, where's Ron Isley at? Like, I didn't see him, right? I was like, I didn't notice him, right? I didn't recognize
him.
I'm like, where is he at? I saw this, the cool, smooth dude. Oh, he took the hat off and he had the little flat top. I was like, oh.
He switched his hair up and now he got the little, you know, salt and pepper. He got the gray in his beard.
I'm like, how old is he?
He's good, 79, though. Man. Yeah, yeah, looking really great. Looking great.
Oh, we look good. We better be dressed and fly like that.
And even Philip Bailey from Earth, Wind & Fire, like he's 69.
Is that the one
looks like that? No, that's Verdeen.
Philip
Bailey has a little, you know, dreads with the fade on the side and everything. But nah, yeah, like it's crazy too.
I was gonna say, like, that's our perspective. Like, for you, there's somebody that has like has probably grown up listening to this music. What was your experience?
So listening to, I know they're both your catalogs, not like deep. You know, some of them yes, some of it no. But and listening to that, like they had some deep cuts on that, which was surprising. Like I would think that they would only have the hits on there, but they had the hits and then some on the cheat sheet on Apple Music. But just listening to it, I was like, damn, like you said, the musicianship, like these, the lyrics, the melodies, the beat, like all of that was just ridiculous. And like you said, the amount of hip hop that both of those groups, but especially the Isleys, really birthed is amazing, man. Even you heard it when Ron stepped up, when what was it, Between the Sheets came on, he said, I love it when you call me Big Papa. You know what I mean? So just, it's amazing that that those groups, and not every member, still have the members alive to go and be able to perform. And the last concert that I went to before COVID happened was actually Earth, Wind & Fire at the Hollywood Bowl.
Nice.
So, growing up on that music, my parents played a lot of different music. That was one of them. My grandparents, my parents, that was one of them. But it's just amazing. Like their music, both of those groups, is so beautiful. Like Earth, Wind & Fire is like uplifting and just about humanity and unity, and the Isley Brothers is about love and love making. You know what I mean? So I think both of those groups are etched in history, and the amount of awards that they've won, the amount of recognition that they've got and sales that they've garnered is just amazing. Two of the greatest groups ever in any genre.
Yeah, they're making money.
That's dope that this could be put on, like this type of show, because there's so many people. From what I saw on social media, there's a lot of like people that grew up being fans of them around that time got to experience this again in a different form. But like, you know, that's cool, like that they got to enjoy their music again. And you know, we got to see, I saw a bunch of videos of some people, you know, really living it up. And that's cool. That, I think that's dope that Versus has become what it is right now. And then what I wanted to say is that Versus brought in a new audience, right? They got a new audience. So they're going to grow. They're going to expand. And then the next Versus is Method Man and Redman. Okay. And so like that audience, now they got them tuned in. And now they're going to get them high on the next one. And they're going to get a different experience.
Definitely. But it was, to go back to that, like, it's cool that that's 5 decades worth of music that, you know, those groups have put out. And you talking about, like you said, all age groups, from people that are in their 80s all the way down to their 30s and 20s that appreciate what they saw. And then, like you said, we got Meth and Red next. Like, that's going to be an experience. What date is it on?
420.
Oh.
What do you got?
Huh?
What do you got?
I mean, the last few verses haven't really been verses like that. it's been more of a celebration, which is great. You know, we had Ray and Ghost. I mean, they're partners in Rhyme. You had the Isley Brothers and Earth, Wind & Fire, like two different types, but very similar. And just how do you choose one? And then you got another two partners in Rhyme and Red and Meth. Dang. If I had to choose one over the other, dang.
I got one. At least I'm leaning towards. I'm leaning towards Meth.
Oh, I thought you, Eddie, you're a big Red Meth fan.
Yeah, but still though, yeah. Meth has more memorable.
I think what it is, dang. So
I'm going Red.
I guess they're okay. If you were to compare from a level standpoint, Def Squad or Wu-Tang. Red and Meth on their own, they're kind of neck and neck. It just depends. And then they have, you know, a lot of music and albums together as well. So then that's equal too. So for me, the edge is more towards Method Man, just simply from when you talk about those three aspects. Wu-Tang is going to beat out Def Squad all the time. That's me.
Both legends, though.
For sure.
I can't wait. I guess the last battle we had, a real versus battle, was Keisha Cole and Ashanti. That was the last time I felt like they really
Jesse were... was excited.
They were really going at it. Yeah. And then Jeezy and Gucci. That was the last time. But yeah, you're right. The last have been like celebrations. So I kind of see Meth and Red going, being a celebration also. Which will be cool to see, because like that's our era, you know.
I gave you homework for SZA. Yeah, I gave you homework for Insecure.
Okay.
I gave you homework for Snowfall. Gave you homework for listening to the Isleys and Earth, Wind & Fire, and you've passed every one. You are a great student. But
man, I need a piece of paper so I can put this on the fridge. Take it home.
But you delved further into it. You were watching Snowfall more with Jesse recently. All so right. you're not caught up, but you know, you're making some progress.
Yeah, so since I was chilling with Jesse out in San Antonio, we took advantage and we watched the first episode out there of season one.
And what did you take away from the first episode that you saw?
I was tuned in to like the storyline. I was like, where is this gonna go? Like right away I was like, oh, this is some good writing. And the fact that it was in LA, obviously being from Southern California, I was like, okay, you know, it's familiar for me at least. And I could tell right away that it was something I was probably gonna be watching more. So I flew back obviously to California, and the first thing I did the first night that I was back, I'm like, let me keep watching. And I think I watched another two episodes. So it's been about a week now since I've been back. I'm on episode 7 now, season 1. But I'm tuned in. I'm invested. I think I've been missing out. But then that's how I work with shows, though. I usually don't watch when it's hot. I'll catch up later on. But I can see why a lot of people love the show. And I'm excited to see what's going to come of it. I think it's some dope writing. And the first episodes, though, I could tell Franklin don't know what the hell he's doing. And, you know, but I am rooting for him. I'm like, man, I hope this dude wins. And I'm sure he will. And, you know, no spoiler alerts. But, yeah, I'm tuned in.
Well, they got picked up for a fifth season. So things ain't looking too great right now. They got two more episodes for the season, right, Jesse? Mm-hmm. Two more. But obviously we know based on shows and how they go, like, he'll be all right at least until the beginning of next season.
Yeah, cool. It's funny because when I had to sit him down, I was like, hey, let's just watch it, right? So I watched the first episode, and
did you get his consent?
Yes.
You forced him or you got his consent? Consent is important.
Kind of forced him, but I'm just kidding. Okay.
No.
Andy,
that reminds me of the scene in there where dude homeboy they stole his money. They got other homeboy to go out there and help him out, and obviously he didn't want to give him the money, And I thought he was killing them, but that wasn't what was going on. That's not
what was going on.
And I was like, wow, he didn't get consent.
Hey. But when we're looking at it, I was like, dude, crazy character development from how they were. Reed, right? That's the guy, right? The cop, Reed?
Reed slash, what's his other name?
I don't know. He has a gang of them.
He has two. It's Reed and Reed Thompson, and then I don't know his other name. I forgot his other name. No. I don't remember his other name.
But no, I'm just saying, like, man, he was soft in there at first. I'm like, why is he so soft? But it's just crazy how the character development has transitioned so far.
Teddy is his real name.
Teddy. Yeah. Hey, on a side note, right? On a side note, because every time I think about Snowfall, I think about my dad. So I was talking to my dad, and I had bought you up, Beloved. And he was like, my dad said, and I'm saying this word for word.
Okay.
I said something about Blevins. He was like, what the hell is the Blevins? I was like, Blevins, you know, my friend, you know, his name is Ryan. And I was like, he just goes by his last name, right? I don't know why. I was like, his real government. I said your real government name. I was like, but he doesn't like to be called by his real government name. And he was like, I need the damn censor. He was like, Blevins. He was like, who's his daddy? a five heartbeat?
Oh my gosh. That's funny, dude. Was you cracking up?
I was dying, man. I was like, man, I wish I would have recorded this. I was like, you make fun of Blevins. You make fun of him. Now he made fun of you guys. So he got you back.
Some beef.
Okay.
Beef.
Nah, I'm looking forward to the last two episodes. I'm looking forward to Atlanta is filming right now, too. That's one of my favorite shows.
Man, I can't wait for it. I need to revisit all that again.
Andy?
How many seasons is it already?
On two.
Okay, maybe I can. Now I got to work on Snowfall, man. That's a lot. I got to catch up on a lot.
You get there.
Yeah, you get there. And then straight to Atlanta. And then you have to watch the YouTube videos of them breaking down the episode and then go rewatch the episode to catch everything that you missed.
Oh, Atlanta, I watched those episodes over and over again. The one that I watched, I probably watched that the barbershop episode with Bibby, probably a good 20 times. No lie. I'm not lying. The night that it aired, I watched it, I think, 4 or 5 times. It's excessive, but that's how good the show is, and that's how good that episode was.
So yeah, you have to do that. Watch the episode, then YouTube the breakdown of the episode, and then rewatch it again.
And then I got to go read Blevins' tweets about it.
And then since you're so great at homework, we might start paying you. We might start paying you in U-Bucks.
Oh my gosh. I'll take the U-Bucks though.
I got about 5,000 U-Bucks.
Can I buy?
Did you see them?
Yeah, I did. I saw a picture of them.
Man,
crazy.
What was the picture with him where he had them all in the suitcase? U-Bucks, by the way, are Usher Bucks. For those of you guys that don't know, Usher has his own money.
He's got money.
Find the story.
He so had was $1 bills, $100 bills.
The singer was accused of making it rain fake dollar bills with his face on them at a strip club. What?
Can you imagine?
Did Usher use fake money with his own face at the strip club? And here's a picture, which is probably going to be our intro. Our cover. In April 2021, a rumor started circulating on social media that the R&B singer Usher was handing out fake dollar bills with his name on it at the strip club. The rumor was very largely based on an Instagram post that showed a picture of some fake money or Ush bucks along with the text. My GF posted this. I've never seen this level of effery. Celebs, most of the time, they suck. Cheap as So disrespectful. This is foul. Working so hard to get nothing in return. This is a joke. Their job is to entertain. Take your cheap back home. Oh, cheap ass back home. Sorry.
So then I saw a meme. Remember the rush cards?
Uh-huh.
It was an Ush card.
Just take the R off of it.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. All the memes and the tweets were hilarious.
I see the picture. I see the suitcase with him standing on it.
Yes.
Why is he in Andy's backyard?
Supposedly, I guess like he had it because it was like for some promotion or something like that, like some promo that he was doing. But why do you still have it with you?
But hold on. Is this story from a time ago that he did this, or he did this recently?
April 2021.
Oh, he did this recently. Okay.
In a pandemic.
Hey man,
we're mad.
Shame on him.
People hurting out here.
Strippers need the real money.
We dance all night, and for Usher, and he threw this.
We need to go protest for the strippers. Shorty, I don't
mind. If you dance on the pole, that'll make you a hoe. See?
Bucks.
Get that money.
Usher. Maybe like 100,000 get you like a handshake from Usher.
Maybe you could buy Bitcoin with it.
That's funny, man. What about NBA, man? Let's get into some NBA.
We ain't talked about basketball in a long time.
Been a few times we haven't talked about basketball.
Yeah, Lakers won tonight. Hey. Lost yesterday. Lost to the better New York team. Beat the sorry New York team.
I'm mad at the Lakers though.
Why?
Because like, how do you win? How do you beat? Which I'm glad they beat the Nets. Great win. And then they come back the next night, and then they lose to the Knicks. Like, they should be double. I know, but they should beat the Knicks.
They should be. They're good right now.
But they had to pay bet to Julius. Julius was like, hey, let me get this one. So they're like, all right.
Julius Randle. So I don't know if you heard the story. We'll get back to Kyrie in a second. But obviously, he's a first-time All-Star this year. He's playing Beast. Great. One of the kids that we loved.
Yeah.
You know, from the baby Lakers.
Jesse had a jersey.
See? Number 30. Juju. And always wish, you know, those baby Lakers well. But I don't know if you guys seen the story to where something that he took from Kobe is whenever he arrives into, you know, a new city, they got a game going on. The first thing that he does is put up shots. And so, you know, I think they were going to Detroit and he was able to find a gym that was all night. It was a high school. And the person that let him in the gym was like, man, wow, that's really admirable that you're in here putting up shots, trying to get better at your craft, you know, doing this late at night. A lot of young guys aren't doing that. Actually, the last person that I saw do that was Kobe Bryant. So the fact that Kobe encouraged him to do that whenever he goes into a new city before the game, and that he went and did that, and the person, it's all full circle. The person that let him in the gym said that the last person he knew to do that was Kobe Bryant. Like, that's amazing. And they said, Julia said he got chills after that when the dude told him that.
And he led by example too. So now his whole team, goes with them.
And that's why they out here winning. You got to sacrifice to win. And that's in life, period, whether it's sports or, you know, career.
And I know we're gonna get back to Kyrie, but since you mentioned Kobe, today is his five-year anniversary of the last game that he played, mm-hmm. which was 4/13. Do you guys remember we all shared that day because we were together?
That was amazing.
Yeah, yeah. Man.
Memorable experience. That is etched in my memory.
No, mm-hmm. for sure. So that goes to me. Obviously, like we talk about all these things, but. I just love that we got that together as friends. Like, we got moments we can go back and like share like about things that we enjoy together. But that was one of them, for one of my favorites. And then obviously Kobe's one of our favorite players of all time. But how he has impacts on like NBA players down to like the fans like us, that like, you know, that's how good he was. So that's dope. It's, man, miss him. Rest in peace.
For sure.
Yeah, let's get on this Kyrie, man. What's up with your boy Kyrie?
He got ejected for going back and forth and being in Dennis Schroeder's face. Actually, both of them got ejected. Mm-hmm. And Dennis used the N-word towards him, and he was like, don't call me the N-word. You don't know me like that, bro, blah, 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 blah. So then he went on Twitter, was it? Yeah, Twitter, and was telling everybody not to use the N-word anymore and, you know, all this stuff. So what's y'all's views on that? Andy, from, you know, you coming from a different perspective. Jesse got a little bit of a different perspective, and then I do as well, in terms of when you look at our background and our makeup. So
I'm not going to touch on the N-word, but I will say this, that, like, it's right in line with who he is and who he's showing us to be, as far as, like, his emotions. So, I mean, I'm not surprised. I mean, it's just sports. I feel like, you know, you scuffle a little bit while you play, and sometimes, like, you know, one player gets the best of you, or you don't like the way this player's playing and whatnot, and, you know, they push each other and the emotions rose a little bit. But what I don't like about what's going on with Kyrie, and, you know, with all due respect to his situation and whatever it is that he's going through and his, you know, family issues, is that, like, he's leaving the team again the next game and then not playing, and he's done this more than a handful of times this year. And so, like, that's what I don't like about what I'm seeing from him, because at the end of the day, like, when you're on a team, there's a certain level of, like, responsibilities that, especially if you're a team leader and you're one of the elite players, like, no matter what, like, you have responsibility to your team members. Obviously, you have responsibilities outside of basketball, which, that's why I, like, with all due respect, I don't know his situation. But I just don't like the fact that he's been doing that so much. And I think that that's going to affect, obviously, their team going into the playoffs. But that's my outlook on it.
Well, they just said Jimmy Butler's just going to call him the N-word all game if they ever play him. So, and he's just going to lead a game. So, you know, that, like you said, it is going to affect his team.
And when you show your cards, you letting other people in to, like, all right, this is what bothers him. I'm just going to do that. And guess what? His emotions might rise up again. I don't know.
But you don't have an opinion about, you know, the players using that word and his view on it versus any other word that you could use that you would get in trouble for.
Listen, this is what I say. So I got canceled on the last pod because I said color people,
yeah.
Yeah, which I'll never, we won't touch on that again. Wild, yeah. But, all right, but listen, so playing basketball almost my entire life, on the court, people say what they say. Right, my entire life I've heard everybody say that word playing basketball. You know, it's just something that comes out of black people. Like, I feel like that's just during the game, like, either it's a celebration, like it could be a word of celebration, or it could be like somebody that's upset because of a call, because of a foul, whatever it may be. And so I've never partaked in that. I've never participated. I don't have emotions towards it because I'm not obviously black. And I've never used that word. And I'll never use that word.
What word?
That word.
What word? Say it.
Andy, I've seen Andy, because obviously he said he's played basketball a long time. Sorry. I've seen him hit that game winner shot, and in his head, he says, I'm that. Seen it in his head. Saw his brain moving, like,
nah, never, Jesse, never.
What's your view on it?
Somebody was,
What's your view, Jesse?
So, I was watching not First Take, Undisputed this morning, and they were kind of talking, and it kind of made sense. It's just that he's, like, trying to be in touch with his roots now, right? He's trying to see a different avenue of trying to reach his African
enlightenment,
heritage, right? Enlightenment, right? So, I think now, him educating himself in the African culture, that now that's kind of offensive, right? So maybe that word kind of triggers him, because maybe he doesn't associate himself with that, or he sees it as a bad thing because his views change, right? And that's very understandable, because maybe that's how he's coping with what he's doing, or, you know, who knows? But I think there is a point where you should have respect for those people, right?
If you know someone's Muslim, you're not going to call them a pig, right? You're not going to say something mean, you know, if you know. I think you just have to kind of be cautious, and he makes it public. But then in Schroeder's case, it's the game. He's the guy's all in his face, and reactions happen. Like, you sometimes you might forget. You could say, yeah, do this and do that. But in the heat of the moment, something's going to come out. Words are going to come out. And I don't think he meant nothing bad about it. I think Kyrie maybe overreacted. He could have went a different way.
Sure.
But people have their views. Like, if somebody calls me that word, I'm not going to be mad. Like, I'm not going to, if it's another brother, Tel Aviv.
Party up is your favorite song. Love to call black people brothers. If it's another brother.
I didn't want to say color
hey,
people.
Hey, my brother. Hey, brother.
Canceled, man.
Nah, not canceled. He's funny. That's funny. The fact that, hey, yeah, there was a guy and he was another brother. What? Who says that? Nah, hey, that's a black man.
That's what makes this podcast so great, though, gosh. Because look, I'm Hispanic. Hey. Jesse's over here white.
Jesse's yeah.
And you're black.
So no, I'm a brother, apparently.
You got triggered for be called your brother. So that's you just Kyrie. You got the same haircut.
That's funny. Now what for you me,
think?
Like
what you think?
I don't use that word. Obviously, not I'll say obviously, but I used to use that word. You know, growing up, listening to hip hop, you know, being in the black community, like we use that word all the time. So I don't use that word. I haven't really used that word in several years now. You know, I switched up my vocabulary, changed things within my life, and that's not one of the words that I use. You know, I'll say it from time to time, you know, depending on the context or, you know, whatever's going on, you know, in the situation that I'm in. But it's not a word that I use regularly at all. And even when the songs come on, like I don't say the word anymore. So there are very few occasions you'll hear that word, you know, uttered out of my mouth. And definitely, as Brandon said, we had a conversation about this, not in mixed company either. Hmm. So for me, I don't really care if other people use it. That's their prerogative. I definitely don't like it when people use the word nonstop. Like, it's very annoying to me. Side note, also when people are like, bro, 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 oh, bro, hey, bro, nonstop. Like, that's annoying to me as well. Same with the B word. I don't like it, like, when people overuse any type of term or anything like that. So, outside of people like using it nonstop, and using it like in public, you out at a nice restaurant, you talking about, I don't like that either. But if you want to use that, you know, in your vocabulary and it's not being overused, hey, be my guest. Just for me personally, that's not a word I use anymore.
That's like such a question, I feel, for a lot of people. And it's not really a question. It shouldn't be a question. When like anybody else that's not black, that's are they allowed to say it? And like, when is the right time to say it? But for me, the answer is like no and never. But I know that that question does come up. Like, I've been around a few of those conversations, and I mean, my take on it is not a positive word, you know. But mm-hmm. at the same time, like, if people want to use it, obviously, like there.
But you understand it based on the fact that it's steeped in the black culture and hip-hop culture and sports culture. You understand it.
Yeah, like even when the song comes on, I'm gonna skip that word.
Why?
I'm just not gonna say it. I'm not, you know. And then there's no reason for me to say it on everything that I know. There's no reason for me to say it. Like, it's not gonna give me points. And that, and just being honest, it's, I feel like some people feel like that makes them cooler.
Oh, like, for sure. Don't give them
points, or you got credibility. But no, it doesn't. I feel like you get more credibility when you just know that that's not the right thing to say or ever even mention. You know what I mean? Like, but obviously we're different. We're at different points in our lives, and then, you know, for a different bracket of friends, there might be a different.
There's so many environments that I've been in where I've been around Hispanic, Mexican, Latin people, some white people, who
I hear use the word more than a lot of my black friends and family, and that bugs the shit out of me.
Yeah.
Like, for real. And I'm like, and they be young kids, like, you know, mid to late teens, early 20s, and I'm like, what are you doing? You know what I mean? Like, how has no one addressed this to you? And in some instances, like, I say something, in some instances I just give a look or won't say anything at all, just because you never know, these days somebody might try to, you know, run up on you. So, you know, I think it's important to be aware of your surroundings and whatnot. So I choose, you know, when to acknowledge certain things wisely. So I don't know. But sticking on basketball, Grant Hill is out here doing big things. He
him and Tamia,
you know, him and Tamia. He out here is gonna be take over USA Basketball from Jerry Colangelo and the Colangelo family.
Let's go,
which is amazing. I know, you know, he went from being at Duke, being a star, to being a star in the NBA, to going through a bunch of injuries and still having a long, you know, impactful career. To, you know, he tried to get with the group to buy the Atlanta Hawks, and that didn't go through. But he's a really good analyst on TNT, a great ambassador for the game, and you know, now he's going to continue on. I think that's dude, that cool that you see a black man in charge of something that major, and you know, he's younger by corporate America standards to be in charge of something like that. So I think that's amazing.
He took over Jerry Colangelo's job?
Yeah, so which is the chairman or whatever, the head of USA Basketball. So the
decision operations.
USA Basketball, yeah.
Yeah. That's big. That's big boy moves right there. That's cool.
Yeah.
That's dope. Yep.
Hey, Grant Hill's the only one to have his feelers in Costco.
Costco? He had them in Costco?
Yes.
I had a pair of Grant Hill feelers.
I wish Grant Hill feelers would... I was a Nike guy the whole time, so I don't know if I've ever had any feelers.
Those were like Timberlands, like either high tops were out. They were heavy.
He had a few different pairs. And then LeBron doing big things too, man. Like, now he's part of the ownership group that you know, has the Fenway Sports Group, which is, you know, the Boston Red Sox, and I think they already have a stake in one of the soccer teams overseas, that I think he has already been involved in that. But now he's part of the Fenway Sports Group. So him and Mav are going to be part of, you know, the Boston Red Sox owners, which is major, especially, again, two black men. And you're talking about Boston, which is notoriously racist city in America. So that's huge. And the fact that, you know, all the rivalry between he and the Celtics, you know, whether it was Cleveland and the Celtics or Miami and the Celtics as well. So that's major, man. Like, two prominent people doing big things.
I think
black man.
He's just playing his cards for him to eventually own a team one day.
It's gonna happen.
Yeah. Then that'd be crazy to see. Like, but just like, it's so fitting though, his whole story.
And yeah.
You're going to write books about him one day, which they're probably write a book now, but he's an inspiration for sure. Don't matter the race. Like, he's just an inspiration as a human being to do all the things that he's been able to do and accomplish.
So looking at them, like, go ahead, Jesse, what'd you say?
He's going to be in the literature books in the future. Part of our history.
You got it. So you said inspiring, like, Who are some people in your life that you know personally or just in our society that really inspire you guys like that?
Mm-hmm. You go, Jesse.
I'm trying to think, man. That's
so for me to look up to, I would say probably Magic Johnson is one of them. Just all he's been able to accomplish. You know, Kobe Bryant from a determination standpoint, somebody who doesn't give up, who doesn't make excuses. And from a personal standpoint, I would say my dad. You know, not that he's perfect or anything like that. You know, he's made a lot of mistakes, but he's done a lot of great things. But he is someone who
doesn't quit and is going to find a way to persevere and overcome and make something happen. And, you know, I want to give him a big shout out and a congratulations just from being an owner. You know, he's seen the highs in life and he's seen the lows, and he's been able to pick himself back up and to be a business owner, to go from, you know, a wonderful life to, you know, the recession happening and losing a lot, and then, you know, grinding and working so hard to provide for his family, and then, you know, going and doing insurance for a company. I think it was Farmers or State Farm, one of the two. Farmers, I believe it was. And then to being his own boss and creating an insurance business. And then now he's in the taxes, and he purchased 3 Liberty Taxes. So this is his first year of owning the Liberty Taxes. So for me, like, he's really an inspiration. He's owned apartment complexes as well. Been, you know, a manager for MCI back in the day when MCI was around. And I appreciate him for what he's done for our family, and the fact that he's inspired me and my 2 sisters to be the best versions of ourselves. Like, he would always tell me, you can do anything in life. Anything that you put your mind to, you can do in life. And I'm going to support you no matter what it is, as long as it ain't illegal. You know what I mean? So he's somebody that really inspires me.
That's fire, man.
Can't even back that up, man.
No, that's dope, man. That's awesome.
I was going to say Hector from all the movies, because he's always consistent, keeping the same role.
Hector?
You know what guy I'm talking about.
Blevins right now, like, party up. He's making a list right now.
Still, man.
Hey, man. But like I said this before, man, you guys, right? Like, you guys are inspiration for me, especially career-wise of me trying to, like, get to you guys' level. I've said that plenty of times before. But I think, you know, I'll echo what you said about Kobe. It's just that mentality, that Mamba mentality of grinding, right? Being better. I remember him just yelling at people at practice, right? And I always just try to utilize that mentality, like, hey,
to yell at people.
Yeah, I was just the same thing. I was like, he's at work yelling
come
at
on people. It's 2021, we can't be like that no more. It was inspiring to us, and that's the generation we grew up in, but we can't treat people like that.
I've learned, but I'm just saying, just to have that determination and that will, right? And you know, sometimes when my day's long, you know, what will Kobe do? What will Kobe do? But I think as far as like a superstar, he's probably one of my my big ones. And I've mentioned, like I said, I talked about Joe Budden on here, the way he transitioned as a rapper to that after rap career. And sometimes now getting old now it's like, you know, you put that in your mind, like, hey, what are we going to do after we're old? You know, we can't stand up for long. Like, what's our future, right? So it kind of puts stuff in perspective just to see how people are doing. And hey, you never know, man. 5 years, we might be some professional podcasters, or we might be, voice announcers for the Spurs. <Just
kidding. laughs> I know somebody that you talk about, that maybe you didn't think about it, but I know that was important to you. That's your grandfather.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, man. Rest in
peace. How did he inspire you?
He just told me, he inspired me to. It's funny because I want to make sure I word this. Get your money's worth. Tell me to get your money's worth. You go to McDonald's, you pay $5 for a sandwich. Make sure you get $5 worth of napkins.
Oh my gosh.
I didn't know where you were going with that one.
I didn't either. We said get your money's worth. I was like, okay. I'll be U-Bucks, U-Bucks, Usher Bucks.
I remember we used to go to Fogo de Chao, And that was his favorite restaurant. And obviously that's one of my favorite restaurants too. We'll be there for 2 hours. We'll eat, talk for 2 hours, eat again. Get your money's worth.
They used to kick y'all out, huh?
Man.
They started the minimum, the time limit after they saw y'all.
Yeah, he ruined it for us.
90 minutes only.
But I just appreciated the way that, you know, he worked hard. And he was able to retire at an early age, and he was very proud of that. I think he retired at the age of 50. And for him to be able just to live the life, travel, and actually me tag along with him was actually great. I know he wanted to take me to Africa one of these years, and unfortunately we weren't able to make it. But I will make it to Africa for him one day. So that's the goal.
Are you going to call all the people out there brothers? Hello, my African brother.
I'm going to go where all the whites are at.
I believe you. I believe you. South Africa. I really believe you.
Hey, Jesse's going to end up
You're going to feel right at home.
No, Jesse's like, yeah, I went to Africa. Where? Egypt? Even though that is Africa, but I'm just, you know.
Andy, who inspires you?
Jesus Almighty.
Okay.
In my later years, obviously I've built a relationship with Jesus, with God, and so his life story, and how he was and how he treated people, like that's impacted me. And to learn that some of my heroes growing up as a young kid, which were Mohandas Gandhi and Martin Luther King, growing up, those were the two people that I remember reading up on them, and it really molded me as a person to be who I am now. Because for you guys to know me, like, I'm all about like love, kind, and just being peaceful and just doing the right thing, right? And reading their autobiographies and their biographies, they're who they molded their lives after was Jesus as well. So for me, that came full circle. I'm like, oh, no matter. I mean, no. I was like, no wonder, you know? Yeah. So those from a hero perspective from a young age, those are the two individuals. In my later years, you guys said it was Kobe. Just growing up idolizing somebody that I thought, like, damn, this man is unstoppable. So, like, as a young kid, you just look at somebody just, like, overcome all the odds, right? And never give up. And you just see him on TV just murdering everything in sight. And so you just grow up thinking, like, I got to do the same. You know, I got to have that same mentality. So Kobe had a huge impact on my life. And then from a personal standpoint, you know, I think both of you guys know my parents. Like, my mom for being the backbone of our family. No matter what it is and no matter what's going on, just being the positive person that she is, loving and caring, quiet, but yet, like, just having strength for all of us, no matter what the situation is. I admire that, and I can only hope to obtain half of the strength that she has. And then my dad, like, man, just from a business perspective, like, he's taught me everything from being a boy to a man, to how to, like, write a check, how to write a check.
I've probably only written
one.
Only one? No, you've written more than one. Less than 10 times I think I've written a check in my life.
He had me. So my dad's old school Hispanic, so he would write the checks, you know. He would
He's old school, I thought he would just have cash.
He had the big wallet with the cash in it too. But yeah, just, you know, he's taught me how to maneuver through life the right way, how to do things the right way. And now that I think about it, like, he's the one who taught me what integrity is. And I didn't learn really what that was until later on in life, that I started to really think about all the lessons that he had given me, still giving me, and how it's molded me to be who I am now. But that's all because of him. Like, and I still look up to him. I still think I'm like, damn, my dad's 58 years old and he's out here having more energy than me sometimes, and he's still moving. Like he doesn't want to stop, and that's, you know, and I admire that. I admire that he still has a fire for life and wants still, you know, to get the most out of life that he can, and you know, so I love that about him, and so. Those are my inspirations, man.
That's a beautiful, though, that each of us, you know, have our dads in our lives to teach us things as, you know, boys and young men. But probably even more so as grown men who have families, who have, you know, homes and careers, to still be teaching us lessons, mm-hmm. and wanting to, you know, kick game down to us. And it's dope that, you know, your heavenly father was your celebrity one and your personal one too.
Yeah.
Yeah, Doug, man, we took him out to Topgolf. And man, that guy had a blast. He was in a candy store. Man, he had fun. Whooped our butt too, just like he did a bowling the first time we introduced him to bowling.
He did, man. I didn't understand what he was doing, but he was killing us.
And I'm pissed that Andy used my profile on Topgolf instead of just creating your own.
Blame Jesse.
And then I get an email saying that I had a score. I'm like, I ain't been to Topgolf in 2 years.
Blame Jesse. Jesse put in all the phone numbers. I just walked into it like, why is Ryan in here?
Why? I don't want that man take. Did you even do well?
Second round I did.
Did he do well?
Yeah.
At the end.
Oh, hell nah. Yeah. That brother did well. Yeah.
You act like Topgolf about to hit you up. Hey, Blev is weird for
that. No, I represent me. I don't want nobody repping me.
This Topgolf called for the international.
No, I don't want him messing up my score.
You're actually invited into the tournament.
Hey, you never know.
Yeah, you never know.
No.
It might be like, hey, send the best people that we got. What you got? Hey, that was a good segment, though. Let's get into some weekly spins.
So damn disappointed. I didn't support no black businesses, man. Shame on me. But I went out with some friends on Saturday night. Oh, so Friday we went to the art gallery. So that was enjoyable. And then we went out to eat after that.
That spot that you went at, that you went to, Carla wanted me to take her there like for a couple months now.
And she hit me up.
Yeah, she was like, Blevins went to the spot that I wanted to go to. So, yeah,
there's go still ahead. Time. There's still time.
For sure. That it looks dope.
No, but it was a nice, you know, small little quaint spot. But like it's a newer hotel. It's crazy because you could see where it has the marquee on the outside. You can see the outline of where it says motel on it. So they need to get a new sign. But it was very nice. The food was very good. The vibe and everything there was dope as well. And then Saturday, shout out to Robbie and David. It was their birthday last week. So we all went out to eat as well. And, you know, we was with Miles and Reggie and, you know, Calvin and Jeanette and everybody. So shout out to you guys. And then we officially kicked Miles out the group chat as well. So we're trying to get new people in the group chat with David and Robbie.
Because
he doesn't respond. He's terrible. He said he wanted to come on the podcast, but he's terrible in the group chat. So if you're not going to be involved, like, you got to get out. Like, my group chat with you guys is booming. Like, that's always good. Sometimes Jesse don't respond.
How come you haven't kicked Jesse out?
Group chat with with Lloyd and Brandon is really good as well. And then the group chat with my sisters and my mom, I enjoy that one. So those are the three group chats that I'm in on the daily. If anybody wants to adopt me into a group chat, I'm ready, willing, and able. I don't really like being in group chats that have more than 4 or 5 people in them. So if you got like 8 and 10, that's a little overwhelming for me. But I'm, you know, if you're accepting applications, I want to put my application to being in the group chat.
Give your number out to everybody.
909.
I mean,
nah.
You put the number in Topgolf, so.
you spent some money, you know, feeding the LA streets. I see you.
Yeah.
Man, I didn't really buy anything. My wife bought me some stuff. It was our anniversary, so she got me, a new Louis wallet.
Oh,
Master, I got something a little slim, thick.
Okay.
Then I got me some Birkenstocks because you know toes out. Gotta
get these brother.
Got me some Birkenstocks, and then I got me some cologne from Louis Vuitton. I've always wanted some, and I got me some.
Andy.
Smells delicious.
Andy.
What's up?
What does he have?
Money.
Louis.
Got money.
Got Louis.
You got Louis money.
Hey, what about your screen though?
Oh yeah, I got my monitor in nice 49 inch. Like I'm touching side to side. You can't even see. Oh yeah, let me show you.
Okay. Oh, we got some live action here.
Okay, Minority Report.
All right.
Okay. He got the Minority Report monitor. Let's go.
I see you guys.
Hey, nice. Hello, hi.
Yeah. You see the setup is nice.
Okay.
Yeah, it's nice. So I'm not looking up in the roof no more.
You can watch Snowfall and ATL at the same time.
Atlanta, not ATL. That's
Atlanta, sorry.
TI.
Are we allowed to use say TI's name now?
Right. Can you?
What's going on with that? What any
other No. Offline.
Yeah,
offline.
What about you, A? What'd you get?
I actually splurged on myself for the first time in a minute.
Let's go.
But it wasn't black owned. I'm sorry, Blevins.
Damn it.
I've got three things. So I actually copped the Supreme hat that I'm wearing right now.
Let me see it. Turn around.
Fire.
Okay, what is this? Velvet? Is that like satin or something?
Satin, yeah.
Okay.
Wow.
Satin.
Between
the sheets.
Because we got the Peloton, I was like, you know what? I'm gonna get the Apple Watch. So I got the Apple Watch. I haven't had an Apple Watch in a minute. So I got that. And then I did get a new pair of Boost for work, like Adidas Boost.
The 21s?
21s, yeah, with the thick like Boost on the back. Money. Hey, you know, I had to finally splurge a little bit. Okay. You've been having money this whole like last four podcasts.
Yeah.
Which summer?
Exactly.
All right, let's get into these Vibar Nas. Who's first? Oh, Andy.
I've got to go first. Andy, all right.
Can't help you.
All right, man. Vibar Nas, I had to go with the legend. The one song that you could play if you want to get amped up at any time.
Party Up?
No.
Yeah.
No, that's Jesse. Rough Rider Anthem, man. You put this on and you know it's about to get, in Jesse's word, crunk. But no, it's about to get wild. It's about to get wild. So, and this is what I meant. It don't matter what age you are. You could even be 70 and you might see him with a cane. Like, you know, this is that song, Rough Rider Anthem. What'd you say, Jesse?
The song has so much longevity that's why it's impactful to a lot of generations, because you play this in the song club now and it's popping.
And then I don't know how true this is or not, but shout out Jay-Z and Beyonce for buying the rights to his music and then giving it to his kids, from what I saw. I don't know if it's true or not, but
so you shouting them out, but you don't know if it's true.
I don't know, because it's on the internet and I don't know if it hasn't been
everything
confirmed
on
yet.
The internet is real, duh.
Well, that's
a resort to violence. My niggas moving silence like you don't know what I stylish. New York niggas are wild. My niggas is with it. You want it? Come and get it. Took it, then we split it. Fucking right, we did it. What the fuck you gonna do? Keeping up on you. Fucking with the wrong crew. You know what we going through. I'm gonna have to show niggas how easily we blow niggas. It's a moment. Running with your niggas. Nothing we can't handle. Break it up and dismantle. Light it up like a candle. Just cause I can't stand you. Put my shit on tapes. Like you busting grapes. Think you holding weight when you haven't met the apes. Stop. Drop. Shut them down. Open up shop. Oh. Go.
Oh, the whoa. It's panning in my ears.
Stop. Drop. Shut them down. Open up shop. Crazy, what? I bust you and be crazy. Stop acting like a baby.
Mind your business, lady.
People get it too. When you see me spit at you, you know I'm trying to get rid of you. Yeah, I know it's pitiful. That's how niggas get down. Watch my niggas spit round. Make your niggas kiss ground. Just for talking shit. It's funny, you don't know me, buddy. It's about to get hungry.
Dog, I'm hungry.
You know what that means? Come up off that dream. Niggas on ravine. Don't make it a murder scene.
Leave a dog alone. Leave a dog alone. Let a dog roam and he'll find his way home.
Home of the brave,
home is the cave.
Yo, I'm a slave to my home is the grave.
Dang. I think your attention was delayed for you because you were like off a little, or unless you were doing that on purpose.
Who, him or me? Yeah. Me? Yeah. No, I was doing it with it.
Oh, okay. You might be
off. A little delayed, that's all. A
little bit. All right, I'm going to go. this is Yeek, and this song is called Overthinking. Yeek, Y-E-E-K. I'm probably saying it. But this song's a nice little vibe. Bop. Damn, I only got 10 seconds.
Damn, they hate on you.
They ain't showing love to you.
That's because you don't pronounce the names right.
Shout out to Yeek.
He probably said it right this time. Well, we know he said it right last time because it was Rochelle Jordan, right?
Yeah, his yeah. wife.
Yeah.
All right, what you got, Bluff?
I got Good and Plenty, the remix by Lucky Day, Masego, and Alex Isley.
Good and plenty like a Georgia peach tree, picking sweet tweet behind the seas, running down your knees. Water flooding me, feeling up to my teeth. I looked over to the left. I think we should let it rain tonight. No, I love it when we slip inside. Don't stop loving, got a love supply. Sleep, wake up and repeat. You get every little bit. You ain't never seen a drip like this. Heaven at your fingertips. Don't you let a minute slip. Just say you have me.
The spaces in between. It's magic when I place you in the green. An average day is spent all in the sheets. Emphatic when I tell you what you mean
to me.
Chemistry, intimate memory.
That is fire. Whose original song is that? Oh, is that Alex Isley's original song? Because it's a remix.
Let's see.
That's a crazy trio right there.
That is a crazy trio.
I think it's Alex Isley's original song.
I think so. I'm not sure, but yeah, that's a new song.
It's fire. I like it.
All right, well, since I had 30 seconds, I'm ending it on my new album out, Spring Fling, new EP. Cop it. All listeners. Thank you, listeners. We haven't said thank the listeners in a long time. Thank you for listening. Please subscribe.
Thank you for listening. Thank you for listening. Yeah, definitely. Man, it's always cool to see people or hear people talk about what we got to talk about, what we talk about. I always get it randomly, too. Somebody hit me up, be like, why'd you say that? Or like, you guys are wildin'. And I always think to myself, that's crazy. They listen. But I appreciate it.
Though. Why'd you call us colored people?
Yeah, I got a call about that. Yeah.
I know this is a little late on here, but I hope people know, like, sometimes we have to argue the fact because we all probably agree on the same stuff. So we have to throw wrenches in there. We're not going to just agree on everything.
Blevins don't agree with you.
I don't know. There's a lot of stuff I don't agree with you on.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Sometimes you have to flip your thought process, because if we just, I agree on a lot of stuff you say, but I'm not going to say it because then we'll all just agree with each other.
It's very hard to believe that you would agree with some of the things that I say.
I have to throw my wrench in. I'm just, I'm a wild card. Gotta be.
You are out there.
Spring Fling EP, Spring Dance. It's Dandy's favorite right here. One of my favorite ones too. Let's go. Send it on this. Can't wait to be out in the club on this one.
You've been talking about the club the whole podcast.
I don't even know where I would be.
How old are you?
I would get those Usher bucks and just be like.
How old are you?
34.
And you still in the club?
Nope.
This is.
You just said it.
An outdoor spot.
Yeah, let's get the vibe. Come on.
Hey! This is like a concert. Outside concert.
I see you bobbing your head. Come on, give him a little something else. Ready? Here you go.
You really mustn't, darling.
Hey, we gotta get you on Solection, man.
I'm trying to. This is out on all DSPs. Please go listen. I'm trying to get on Solection, man, one day.
It'll happen. Consistency.
Yeah, man, that's hey, if you go back and listen to, you just go to Apple Music and listen, Head the Real One, listen to all those mixes that we have on there that I put out. It's a vibe.
What about Blev the Name?
Blevins the Name.
Blevins
the Name. I can get my name right.
Not bad. Hey, so next.
Who's Blevins?
Maybe 2 weeks we'll come back with a Dubai recap. Wish us well. Safe travels. We're going to have a lot of stories to tell. And
you guys are going to become someone's concubine.
Wow. So I read something, I don't know if it's true, and I don't think we would have any issues with this, but a guy went to the hospital, a tourist, and they drug test him, and he had marijuana in his urine, so they detained him.
I believe that.
Crazy.
They don't play.
Nah.
So make sure you just get the oils instead of the, the sticky.
We ain't did none of that.
You just said you guys are gonna be out there on 420 watching Redman and Method Man.
We gonna be on the plane.
Best behavior.
Oh, you come back on the 19th?
No, we leave on the 19th.
We leave on the 19th.
But you know the 13-hour time difference. Mm-hmm. We already gonna be on April 21st when we land. We gonna miss life. but then coming back, we gain life. So. More life.
Hey, we actually got stuff on the flight though too. So we have Wi-Fi.
All right, okay. You better watch it.
Might be able to just download the Triller app.
There we go.
All right, y'all, be safe.
Oh, and Snowfall.
Oh yeah,
Atlanta.
Oh, we could watch it all. 15
ATL.
Hours.
ATL.
That's 15 hours there.
There you go.
For sure.
You got it, man. That's 15 episodes. All right, man. Be safe, y'all.
All right.
Peace.